Hey everybody, this is Steve Christensen, and in this video I will share 10 tips to prevent and treat iris prolapse. First, let's begin with prevention.
Tip number one is to create a longer wound. One of the factors driving the pressure-driven movement of the iris to the wound is the distance from the iris to the internal opening of the corneal wound. If you are concerned about the potential for iris prolapse, consider making a slightly longer clear corneal wound. Tip number two is to avoid overfilling the anterior chamber with viscoelastic. Beginning cataract surgeons, myself included, often overfill with viscoelastic as it is easier to make the main wound in a firm eye. However, this creates a larger pressure differential between the anterior and posterior chambers and increases the risk of iris prolapse, particularly during hydrodissection. A rule of thumb that I try to follow is that if I am getting a lot of viscoelastic spilling out of the paracentesis, I have probably overfilled the AC and should be wary of possible prolapse. Tip number three is to remove excessive viscoelastic before hydrodissection. This video shows a resident surgeon treating iris prolapse by removing viscoelastic from the AC, but the same principle applies to preventing iris prolapse. Hydrodissection poses the greatest risk of prolapse, and taking measures to prophylactically lower the anterior chamber pressure by removing viscoelastic is critical in this prevention. Tip number four is to create a fluid tract before hydrodissection. Here you can see the surgeon injecting BSS and manually creating a path for the BSS to exit the eye in hydrodissection. This helps avoid the situation where the BSS cannot leave the eye without taking with it viscoelastic, which could result in a rapid decrease in the anterior chamber pressure, which is a main risk factor for prolapse. Tip number five is to support the iris mechanically with iris hooks or with a ring stabilizer. This can be done by either placing a single iris hook posterior to the main wound or by placing the hooks in a diamond configuration with one of the hooks posteriorly in a similar fashion. Alternatively, a Malugin ring stabilizer can be used as seen here. Mechanically supporting the iris is particularly helpful if you are concerned about possible intraoperative floppy iris syndrome. Now let's talk about intraoperative treatment of iris prolapse. As soon as iris prolapse occurs, the knee-jerk reaction is to want to immediately push the iris back into the eye. It can be tough to overcome this urge, but realize that it is usually in stuffing the iris back in that pigment is permanently lost from the posterior iris. Also, rarely is this actually effective. Instead, you should immediately go to the paracentesis and release trapped fluid or viscoelastic to decompress the AC. In this case, you can see that burping viscoelastic helps create a potential space to reposit the iris, but this is actually not enough, and only by removing excess viscoelastic using a cannula followed by additional burping from the main wound was the iris able to be reposited easily. Tip number seven is to once again decompress the anterior chamber and then reposit the iris. Here we show a case of iris and lens prolapse during hydrodissection. The surgeon does a nice job to resist the urge to reposit the iris immediately and recognizes the fluid trapped behind the lens, going in with a Drysdale to gently rock the lens, releasing the trapped fluid. The iris can then be reposited. Here you can see a case of prolapse during irrigation aspiration. The first move is to decompress the anterior chamber from the paracentesis, as we've mentioned multiple times before. Tip number eight, which you can see here, is to gently stroke the main wound with a cannula. This helps the iris to be released back into the eye. Once you have successfully put the iris back into the eye, you should then be thinking about how to keep the iris from prolapsing again during the remainder of the case. One option, as you can see here, is to lower the intraocular pressure or bottle height and decrease the aspiration flow rate, which helps avoid large fluctuations in anterior chamber pressure and decreases the risk of repeat prolapse. The final tip is to avoid making a bad situation worse. After prolapse, the iris architecture has been disrupted, and even a seemingly simple step like inserting the IOL could catch the peripheral iris and cause an iridodialysis. Notice here the subtle pause after inflating the capsular bag to place viscoelastic right below the main wound to then create more space for IOL insertion.
Managing iris prolapse seems simple, yet it can nonetheless be challenging to deal with, as you've seen from these excerpts of my own surgical videos, as well as segments of videos published by Dr. Tom Oding at the University of Iowa. I hope you have found these tips to be helpful. Once again, this is Steve Christensen. Thanks for watching.